Of all the equations of physics, perhaps the most magical is the Dirac equation, remarked MIT professor Frank Wilczek. Paul Dirac believed that the fundamental laws governing the universe could be expressed through pretty mathematics. When he wrote down an equation to describe the electron, he noticed something odd. His equation predicted the existence of antimatter, the mirror image of matter. If matter is like the salt flats of the Salar de Uyuni in Bolivia, antimatter emerges as its reflection, revealing the mysterious symmetry of the universe. Dirac predicted the existence of the antimatter counterpart to the electron, the positron, subatomic particles with the same mass as electrons that carry a positive electric charge, in contrast to the electron's negative charge. If the two come into contact, they annihilate each other, converting both particles into energy. For a man best described as an agnostic, he remarked, "God is a mathematician of a very high order." Dirac was a lonely man who grew up a lonely boy, and this had a profound effect on his personality and possibly his work as a theoretical physicist. He told a colleague, "I never knew love or affection when I was a child," as described in the book The Strangest Man by Graham Fermello. Paul Dirac's father, Charles, insisted his three children speak to him in his native French. At dinner, Paul would sit in the living room eating with his father, while his older brother, Felix, and younger sister, Betty, sat in the kitchen, having dinner with their British mother, Florence. When Paul mispronounced a word in French or misgendered a noun, his father punished him by making him stay put, even if he felt like throwing up. Paul Dirac reflected, "Since I found that I couldn't express myself in French, it was better for me to stay silent." He remained quiet into adulthood, preferring to work alone. He spoke so little that his colleagues jokingly defined a unit called a Dirac as one word per hour. Charles's strict educational regime at home mirrored how he taught French at the Merchant Venturer School in Bristol, where Paul was a student. World War I indirectly benefited Paul. As the older students left for military service, it freed up space and resources for him to advance through the upper classes, accelerating his learning. His father insisted that he and his brother study engineering at Merchant Venturers College, which was eventually absorbed by the University of Bristol. However, Paul was not cut out for such a life. One summer spent as a trainee in a factory resulted in a report describing him as a positive menace. When he failed to find employment upon graduation, owing to the serious post-war economic depression, his father suggested he study at the University of Cambridge. Dirac secured a spot, but couldn't get a big enough scholarship to attend. Instead, the head of Bristol University's mathematics department arranged for him to get an applied mathematics degree, which he finished in 2 years. When he applied to Cambridge again, he was able to secure the financial aid that he needed, allowing him to enroll as a graduate research student in 1923. He was lucky to study under Ralph Fowler, a distinguished physicist who introduced Dirac to the cutting-edge field of quantum mechanics, the science of the very small, atoms and particles. With the exception of taking long walks by himself on Sundays, Dirac lived and breathed science. Fowler's lectures on Niels Bohr's theory of the atom fascinated Dirac. Much like planets orbiting the sun in a fixed path, Bohr suggested that electrons orbit at certain distances from the nucleus of an atom. However, Dirac noticed that Bohr's ideas didn't fully explain how electrons behaved in atoms more complex than hydrogen, nor did it consider how electrons act when moving very fast, as described by Einstein's special theory of relativity. While Paul was developing his own theories at Cambridge, his brother Felix was toiling away at a factory in Birmingham, wondering what might have been had he followed his own dream of becoming a doctor. Instead, his father forced him into engineering. Miserable and making little money, Felix's body was found beside a bottle of poison in January 1925. He was 24 years old. Paul was surprised by his parents' grief, telling a friend decades later, "I didn't know they cared so much. I never knew that parents ought to care for their children. But from then on, I knew." Charles was in such deep grief that his doctor advised him to take a year off work. Meanwhile, Paul carried on at Cambridge. In the summer of that year, His supervisor, Fowler, introduced him to a groundbreaking paper by German theoretical physicist Werner Heisenberg that would change Dirac's life. Heisenberg proposed a new way of understanding atoms, challenging Bohr's models of electrons in fixed orbits. Since the exact paths of electrons cannot be measured, he suggested focusing on what can be measured, such as the energy levels of electrons. Heisenberg developed matrix mechanics, a mathematical framework to describe the jumps between energy levels. Imagine your car going from 0 to 60 miles an hour instantly, without moving through intermediate speeds, akin to an electron skipping steps as it transitions between energy states. Shortly after, Austrian physicist Erwin Schrödinger presented a different view, depicting particles as waves spread through space. This model accounts for strange phenomena like the double slit experiment, where electrons act like waves rather than particles, creating interference patterns. Heisenberg's matrix mechanics and Schrödinger's wave mechanics are different ways of describing the same quantum phenomena, like reading the same book in two languages. Author Fermello described their impact this way. Heisenberg and Schrödinger had knifed a sack of gemstones, and the race was on to pick out the diamonds. Dirac took both their ideas and ran with them. Published in January 1928, the Dirac equation accurately describes the behavior of electrons moving at any speed. The equation introduced spin, a quantum property providing particles with intrinsic angular momentum, much like the spin of a planet on its axis. American theoretical physicist John Van Vleck likened Dirac's explanation of spin to a magician's extraction of rabbits from a silk hat. Yet, within the beauty of the Dirac equation lay an anomaly. It allowed for electrons to have negative energy. This baffled scientists because, in classical physics, the energy of electrons, like that of all objects, is always positive. Dirac proposed a bold solution to this conundrum. He suggested the existence of a sea of negative energy states filled with electrons. Should an electron escape the sea by gaining sufficient energy, it transitions to a positive energy state, leaving behind a hole. The hole is not filled by another electron due to the Pauli exclusion principle, which prevents two electrons from occupying the same state. This hole behaves like a positively charged particle, identical in mass but opposite in charge to the electron, acting as its antimatter counterpart. So Dirac's theory not only resolved the negative energy puzzle, but predicted the existence of antimatter, based purely on mathematical logic rather than empirical evidence. His hypothesis was met with skepticism. Fermello in his book describes how the critical chorus had swelled from a whisper to a roar. Heisenberg was concerned he might be wrong. So was physicist Wolfgang Pauli. Bohr was among those who were skeptical of the whole theory, and he confronted Dirac directly, asking, "Do you believe all that stuff?" Dirac simply responded, "I don't think anyone has put a conclusive argument against it." He would be proved right a few years later. In 1932, Carl Anderson at Caltech was observing the effects of cosmic rays within his cloud chamber. He captured a photo of a charged particle curving in a manner that indicated a positive charge. Anderson had stumbled upon the positron, the antiparticle to the electron, providing the empirical evidence to support Dirac's theory. When asked later why he did not speak out more boldly to predict the positron, Dirac said it was because of pure cowardice. Anderson's confirmation of the existence of the positron catapulted Dirac to fame. The following year, 1933, he was awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics alongside Schrödinger for their contributions to atomic theory. Dirac was initially reluctant to accept the prize as he hated publicity. But when others pointed out he'd receive even more publicity for turning it down, he accepted. At 31, he stood atop the scientific world, his contributions defying the expectations of his peers. His personal life was also poised to defy expectations. He was so quiet and awkward that there was never any expectation that he would find love. Dirac once asked Heisenberg why he danced, to which Heisenberg replied it was a pleasure to dance with nice girls. Dirac responded, Heisenberg, how do you know beforehand that the girls are nice, as described by Formello in his book? Despite his social awkwardness, he managed to find a partner who understood his unique mind. In the 1930s, during his sabbatical at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton, New Jersey, his colleague, physicist Eugene Wigner, introduced him to his sister Mansi, who was visiting. What began as a friendship blossomed into more. Despite Dirac's initial hesitation, articulated in this letter to Mansi, "You should know that I am not in love with you. It would be wrong for me to pretend that I am. As I have never been in love, I cannot understand fine feelings." This didn't deter Mansi. They later married, and Dirac raised Mansi's two children from her first marriage, and together they welcomed two more children. They settled in Cambridge, where Dirac held the Lucasian Professorship of Mathematics at the University of Cambridge, one of the world's most prestigious academic posts, for over three decades. By the late 60s, his scientific work began to take a back seat to his home life, where he began to focus on his gardening. It was time for a change. Dirac had always enjoyed his visits to America and now sought to settle there with his wife permanently. When he was appointed professor of physics at Florida State University, a department then ranked 83rd in the US, the department head likened it to the English faculty recruiting Shakespeare. Despite such high praise, Dirac did not view himself in the same light. In a candid conversation with physicist Pierre Raymond of the University of Florida, Dirac confided, "My life has been a failure." That shocked Raymond. Author Formello described it this way: Raymond would have been less stunned if Dirac had smashed him over the head with a baseball bat. Dirac's dissatisfaction stemmed from the failure of quantum mechanics to explain something as simple as the interaction between an electron and photon without resorting to infinite values, making him view his work as unsatisfactory. Raymond was shattered by Dirac's assessment, remarking, "I could hardly believe that such a great man could look back on his life as a failure. What did that say about the rest of us?" Yet, in the eyes of the world, Dirac is far from a failure. In a testament to his enduring legacy, Dirac's equation, a cornerstone of quantum mechanics, was immortalized on the stone floor of Westminster Abbey. Dirac lived out the rest of his years in Tallahassee, Florida. On October 20, 1984, he died of heart failure at his home with his wife by his side. He was 82 years old. One of the most profound implications of Dirac's work is the asymmetry in matter and antimatter. According to standard physics models, the Big Bang should have produced equal amounts of matter and antimatter, meaning they would have annihilated each other, leaving a universe filled only with energy. And yet, our universe is dominated by matter, which makes possible the formation of stars, galaxies, and everything we see, including ourselves. It remains one of the great mysteries in physics. Paul Dirac unlocked the mysteries of the universe through his profound understanding of the fundamental principles of science and math. If you have a quest for knowledge and would like to brush up on your STEM skills, I can't recommend Brilliant enough. Brilliant is a website and app where you learn by doing, with thousands of interactive lessons in math, science, data science, programming, and AI. Each lesson lets you play with concepts, which is way more effective than watching lecture videos. Brilliant recently launched a ton of new content in data, using real-world datasets from Starbucks, Spotify, and X to train you to see trends and make better informed decisions. If you're interested in programming, you can familiarize yourself with Python and start building programs on day one with a built-in drag-and-drop editor. One of my favorites is the course on how LLMs work, large language models that have the fascinating ability to generate text that's nearly indistinguishable from human writing. This immersive AI workshop lets you explore how LLMs build vocabulary, select the next word, and so much more. And the best part is, Brilliant is free for you to try out for 30 days. Just scan my custom QR code on your screen to check it out, or click my custom link in the video description, brilliant.org/newsthink. If you sign up with my custom link, you'll get a 20% discount on Brilliant's annual premium subscription, which gives you access to all of their interactive offerings. Thanks for watching. For NewsThink, I'm Cindy Palm.